and I first begin by acknowledging that we are convening on stolen indigenous people's lands. And I honor all of you, and I'm very happy to be here today. Thank you, Greg, for inviting me. Thank you, Susan, for working on curating this. I should say, and I do want to say that Susan has been part of actually a very long time project, and Miranda is here too. Break the Silence Mural Project, which started back in the 1980s, early 80s, to build projects in Palestine, to paint murals on the inside walls in Palestine, because the wall, painting outside wasn't allowed. And during our delegation, the U.S. Anti-Prisoner Labor and Academic Delegation, and I know Claude, Diana, Susan, Jaime are here. There are a lot of other comrades in the Bay Area, but they're not here today. We went and we visited some of the work that you've done. So this is also part of the solidarity that continues for a very long time. I was trying to think, what should I say today? I have a lot to say and we have very short time. So I'm going to say what I wanted to talk about that I'm not going to talk about today. So we can maybe discuss. I wanted to talk a little bit more about the delegation. I actually wanted to talk about what's going on at San Francisco State University and the targeting and attack of ethnic studies in general, indigenous studies and studies of communities of color, and studies of Palestinian, Arab, and Muslim communities. I don't have time to talk about that, but it comes in because it's actually very much relevant to what's going on. But I wanted to remind us that today is May 15th. It's 68 years since the Nakba began, since Israel was founded. And almost a million Palestinians were displaced, uprooted from their lands, and we can even talk about the Zionist plan, the Dalit plan, that was at, the Palestinians were held at gunpoint and displaced in 1948, 68 years ago. But I wanted to talk specifically, I was asked to talk about a couple of questions, so I'm going to focus on the question of art and resistance and link it up back to the project. And I'm sorry, I can't sit, speak sitting down, so I have to stand. Okay. So among those villages, 531 Palestinian villages were destroyed in 1948. But there were a few villages that were not destroyed, that were saved. But they weren't saved in order to uphold the Palestinian cultural production. We visited one of these villages by name of Ain Hod, near Haifa, in the north of Palestine. Ain Hod, and we've, and Ain Hod is a village that was turned into an Israeli artist colony. And if people, and to link it up to what's happening on indigenous lands everywhere, to link it up everywhere, and I'm talking about in all our communities, the ways in which culture gets appropriated, and we've actually had this happen over the spring break at San Francisco State University, when some non-people of color were going around with dreadlocks. Enough said. But this was a huge attack, actually, against one of the African American students at San Francisco State. But this was cultural appropriation. Yes, yes, yes. I'm sorry. Okay. Cultural appropriation. The village was taken over. It was turned into an artist colony. The mosque became a restaurant. And the olive press, the big olive press where Palestinians press the oil, is now displayed in the museum of the village. And this is, and then there is a film, it's called 500 Dunams on the Moon, that if people want to watch it, actually it shows what's going on with that village. So this is one of the ways in which the culture has been appropriated. But it's also the ways in which a people are an attempt to kill a people through the killing of culture and erasure of their lands. And I will come back a little bit, talk with, in a little bit to other forms of cultural appropriation, but it's not just the villages that have been destroyed. The same way as indigenous lands, there is the bones that have been taken away, that people are still trying to reclaim the bones and bring it back. They're still trying to take the Arctic craft and bring it back. Actually, we've met with the director of the Abu Jihad Museum, because we were going to go to the museum itself, but there was a strike by the faculty at Al-Quds University. And of course, we don't cross picket lines, so we ended up not being able to go. Thank you for having the exhibition here. But we met with the director, and he basically told us that there are hundreds of thousands of documents of Palestinian prisoners' writing in prison that has been taken over by the Israeli prison authorities, and they refuse to release them. And these belong to Palestinian prisoners, in order, so we know there is a lot of the stuff has been taken off. Some of the stuff people were able to rescue from George Jackson said, but there's a lot more that has been taken over that belongs to us, because it also doesn't only tell the history as traditional history, but it tells the narratives, the oral histories of a people's struggle and resistance, that by taking it away from us, they are taking away our ways in which resistance is taking place. This also happened in 1982 when Israel invaded Lebanon and took over the archives of the Institute for Palestine Studies and still holds it. This is going on for a very long time. And also to talk about the bones, one of the stories we heard when we were in Palestine, we met with Muhammad Alayyan, who's the father of a young man called Baha'i Alayyan, who was killed, just tell me how much I know. Who was killed by the Israelis in October. And he is one of over 60 Palestinian youth whose bodies the Israelis held. They returned only half of them. And there is about 30 bodies of young Palestinian youth who are still being held captive by the Israeli military in a morgue, in blocks of ice. They would not give the bodies back to the families to bury them and rest to peace their memories with their children. We met with the father, and the father was telling us, in addition to paying a fine, in addition to the home being destroyed, the Israeli military said to him, we will release the body on three conditions. You bury him after midnight, you have only 10 people at the funeral, and you have to bury him in a block of ice. Which means you can't, I mean, he said, how am I going to bury him? And I still remember saying, his hand is over here, another hand is over there, and also you cannot have an autopsy to determine what the cause of death is. There's Israel still maintains something called the Number Cemetery. The Number Cemetery is a cemetery of the bones of Palestinian fighters who've been caught by Israel back in the 70s and the 80s, including the bones of a woman named Dalal al-Mughrabi, who was killed by the former Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Barak in 1978. There is a picture of him holding her head like this and on the beach of Tel Aviv. She was a commander of a militant mission. And her body is still the bones. Why is it that they are still maintaining and keeping the bones together and refusing to release them? So this is another aspect of the ways in which the whole culture of a people, culture of resistance, is being hijacked. I want to actually, Greg tells me 1 minute, and I want to be respectful of the time, even though I think when everybody was told 1 minute, they wanted to get over. I'm going to take the same license. But I wanted to talk about, just move on to the intersection of how do we think about George Jackson, Malcolm X, and other heroes of our people, what happened to them and the connection with the Palestinians. Many people, and I think it was, I don't know where it was, when someone, a man got up and he said to us, what's happening to you? Where is your Mandela? Where is your leadership? And it is the same thing that happened to the American Indian Movement, to the Black Panther Party, Brown Beret, to Red Guard, the New York Green, and every single movement that was present and came. We had something called the COINTELPRO, Young Lords, COINTELPRO, and I don't need to tell you about that, and if you need to know, Claude is sitting back there, and he's one of the makers of the film COINTELPRO 101, which is an amazing film. But this is the same thing happened to the Palestinians. So we had the intellectuals plucked from among the people, like just like people who were assassinated in the prisons here. So Ghassan Kanafani, who was a writer, Ghassan Kanafani actually never held a gun. He was a writer, he was editor of a newspaper magazine called Al Hadab. He's a writer, he wrote a lot, he was a painter. He was killed, assassinated in his home. Najih Ali, the very famous Palestinian cartoonist, who created the figure of Hamdallah, that some of you know, and I think Susan will relate to that maybe vaguely, not painted on the mural at San Francisco State University, was also assassinated. So we had a lot of people who were assassinated in their, exactly what happened to the Black Power movement, to other many movements and so on, because they take away our leadership, and it takes a very long time to grow leadership. Leadership doesn't grow overnight. It's not a couple of people who say we want to do something and there is leadership. It takes a very long time, criticism, fighting, arguing, criticism and self-criticism with each other until you get to the point where, and we can talk about that later on. One of these Palestinian intellectuals is Samih al-Qasem, and I want to just say a little bit about Samih al-Qasem. Actually, Samih al-Qasem was one of the first poets I met after Ibrahim Tukan, who wrote, some of people know the poem Mountainy. But he was in the 30s and 40s, I never met him. But Samih al-Qasim was alive, and I lived under occupation. So in 1967, when we were occupied, I was in the West Bank and I lived in the West Bank. We said at that time, people said Israel occupied the rest of Palestine, but those of us who were living on the West Bank, we said, Dinyan Fathat, ala ba'd. We were opened up to each other. So Palestinians in the West Bank and Gaza actually started connecting with Palestinians in the 48. And one of the first books that came, when the curfew was lifted 6 months later, was a poem, book poem, called Dukhan al-Barakid, the smoke of the volcanoes, by Samih al-Qasim. And Adu al-Shams, enemy of the sun, was one of the main poems. Samih al-Qasim was one of the 20 Palestinian poets. Mahmoud al-Darwish was one of them. Mahmoud al-Darwish became very famous because he left and he went to Beirut and joined the PLO. The 19 others, about whom Tawfiq Ziyad, the former poet and the former mayor of Nazareth, wrote a poem called We Are 20 Impossibles. As if we are 20 impossibles. كَأَنَّنَا عَشْرُونَ مُسْتَحِيلٍ فِي اللُّدِّ وَالرَّمْلَةِ وَالْجَلِيلِ In Lud, Ramla, and Galilee. We, and they, and it goes on to say that we are like a bone stuck in your throat, tells the Israelis, we are going to continue. Samih al-Qasim, people need to know, he was of the Druze faith. And the leadership of the Druze community, in 1948, after Israel was founded, signed an agreement with the Israeli authorities to send the boys of 18 years old to serve in the Israeli military. So there were many young boys who said, we're not going to resist, there's more now. But at the time Samih al-Qasim was growing up, there were very few. Samih al-Qasim was one of the people who refused to serve in the Israeli military and was imprisoned as a result of that. So that also adds to the resistance by various Palestinian communities, because many times people think, oh, Palestinians are only Christians and Muslims. Of course, nobody accounts for Palestinian Jews, Palestinian Buddhists, Palestinian Sikhs, and Palestinian atheists, which is a very big group, by the way. But Samih al-Qasim was one of the people who resisted that. And he remained as a very strong monument, very strong rock in resistance, also informing the young Palestinians today inside Israel who are being called to serve in the Israeli military. And today there is a campaign among Palestinians inside Israel that says, "Refuse the Shabak Yahmik, reject, refuse, and your people will support you. Refuse to serve in the Israeli military. Refuse to serve in an army that oppresses and kills your people. Refuse to be party of that. And think of yourself as a Palestinian in the 48 area, as a people, as a part of the Palestinian people." So, just to end, I wanted to, for me, this and it's very chopped up, I'm sorry, very random comments because there is a lot of stuff to say. I want to kind of like think, what do we, just to ask question, what do we learn from history and how do we understand the different struggles of people and how do we connect them together? How do we think of what happened to George Jackson? How do we think what happened to Malcolm X? How do we think what happened to Leonard Peltier? And how do we think about the struggle of all people? When we talk about free prisoners, we free all prisoners. We never ever say free Palestinian prisoner, we say free Palestinian, all Palestinian, all political prisoner, free Leonard Peltier, free all political prisoners anywhere, Herman Bell, Mumi Abu Jamal, all the people that our delegation brought letters with us from the US to Palestine to bring to Palestinians, and this is the note I want to end in. And the Palestinians at the Institute for Women's Studies at Bir Zeit University translated that pamphlet, it's right there on the wall, it's also at the table of the Freedom Archives. They translated that pamphlet into Arabic because they thought that Palestinian prisoners in Israeli prisons need to read the words, even if they didn't speak English in their original indigenous language, and know that there are people across the world who think about them. The same way now that there are people, more people in Palestine know about George Jackson, and know about what happened in the prison, and know in San Quentin, and know about the Soledad brothers and so on. Now, Palestinians also have the messages from their sisters and brothers in US prisons, going to them and telling them, you're not alone. We are not alone. We're together. Justice is indivisible. We fight. We continue on this day of Nakba. Yes, the Nakba does continue. So does our resistance. Thank you.